में सारे
में डाल दो
ये तो वो बोलेंगे लाइव सेशन स्टार्ट हो सर लाइव हो गए YouTube पे लाइव
विजय सर प्लीज स्टार्ट
ओके ओके सर गुड आफ्टरनून एवरीवन हियर नाउ वी आर स्टार्टिंग अवर सेकंड सेशन विदाउट एनी डिले सो देर आर टू स्पीकर्स फॉर सेकंड सेशन फर्स्ट मिस स्वाति सिंह फ्रॉम जिया प्रोसेस इंजीनियरिंग एंड सेकंड इंजीनियर संतोष चोपड़े सर असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर डेयरी इंजीनियरिंग from College of Dairy Technology, Udgir Mapsu. Okay. So I would like to introduce our first speaker, Ms. Swati Singh from GIA Process Engineering. She completed her BTEC in Food Technology and Process Engineering from Malabar Agriculture University in 2012. After she completed Masters in Food Process Engineering from IIT Kharagpur in 2014. She has skills in the area of membrane filtration, drying, concentration, separation, mixing, liquid milk processing, etc. She is working in GIA Process Engineering since 2014. So I would like to request you, Ms. Swati Singh, to share her knowledge with us. Over to Swati ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Vijay, for such a nice introduction. And I would like to extend my thanks to everyone who is attending this session and for Parul University for arranging such a wonderful webinar in this time. And I've seen that there are more than 2000 registration and 80% of them are student. So I extend my thanks to them also. I'll try and keep my presentation as informative and as fun as possible because I understand this is a after lunch session. So hope I don't bore you to sleep. And let's start this presentation. Please let me know when you can see my screen.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Okay. Okay, so the theme of this presentation of this webinar is engineering for change. And the first two sessions has been so informative and so in depth about how our technology has improved, how our processing has improved. The topic which I received was a very good topic where I can cover a lot of things together. But due to the constraint of time, I have limited a very specific genre. I'll speak to you, give you introduction about GIA and some unit operations and some value added products. So again, let's start the presentation. And anyone of you, if you are not able to see the screen or hear my voice or hear see the presentation, please leave your message in the chat box so we can arrange it for you properly. The agenda for this session, first, I'll give you the introduction of GIA. I understand in first session, Mr. Gulani has very well presented it, but I'll again like to revisit that. Second is the market trend. I understand in the second session, Dr. Chitra Naik has very well described how milk processing has gone up from since 1950s and how we have evolved. So I will take few things from him and we'll build up on how we in GIA have to research the market trend to provide more and more feasible technologies to the current scenario. Next, I'll jump to the advanced technology in liquid milk processing. This will be very valuable and very interesting for the, all the students there. And then value-added product. Value-added product is a new age in dairy processing wherein the new generation, the young generation are more inclined toward having dairy in form of value-added product rather than only drinking the plain milk. So there is a boom in value-added product in the market. You can see in just within 5 years, we have seen so many different kind of yogurts, so many whey drinks, so many flavored drinks in the market, which were not present even a decade ago. So let's come to Gia. As the theme is engineering for change, and you can see Gia logo itself says engineering for a better world. So we always strive to provide a solution which is cutting edge and sustainable. And I'll give you a very brief introduction of how well Gia is set up in the whole processing market, not only food and dairy. You can see in the dairy processing, approx 1/4 of processed milk throughout the world comes from Gia production system. This is how huge we are in the dairy. In the food, you can see every third chicken nugget which you take from McDonald's or any other places, every third chicken nugget is produced by Gia technology. Approx every third process line for instant coffee is installed by Gia. Every second liter of beer, of course, we should not talk that about in Gujarat, but still, every second liter of beer is brewed in Gia solution systems. If we go to pharma, every fourth liter of human blood for making plasma derived products is produced using Gia equipment. We are even into chemical and very strong there also. More than 1/3 of all polymer producers are using Gia drying technology. In utilities, Gia is very well known for its refrigeration technology. In marine, every second container ship in the world sails with Gia marine equipment on board. So this slide gives you a whole view of how big the Gia is, how big globally we are. Now you can see we have a very strong local presence around the globe. You can see we are present in North America, Latin America, North and Central Europe, Western Europe, Middle East, Africa, Eastern Europe, as well as in Asia Pacific. Now coming how we manage all these products and all these portfolio throughout the world. We have a very different R&D and competence center for different technologies. For example, for separation, centrifugation, decanters, we have a separation R&D center in Germany. For homogenization, we have a separate in Italy. For filtration, membrane filtration, as membrane filtration is vast application, it has few more technology center, USA, Denmark, Germany, France. For dairy evaporation, it is in France. For freeze drying and spray drying, basically it is more focused in Denmark, but other places also we have the R&D facilities. For powder handling and filling, we have New Zealand and Australia. For mixing, again, we have Germany and Denmark. And for I have chosen only two value-added products, that is cheese and bakery, and both of them R&D center is in Italy. So this shows you how we are spread throughout the globe with our presence and with our core competence center being in the heart of it. In India, you can see we have head office in Vadodara. We have different branch offices, service branch and manufacturing unit. We have two manufacturing unit, one in Vadodara and one place in Bangalore. So I think this is all about my introduction for you to Gia, so that you can well connect with us in the future slide. Now we will talk about how we work with the market trend. For any company who is so into R&D and providing new technologies, we have to know how the market is working. Gia itself has a market intelligence reports which we generate, and one of the report which says that by the population growth will be 1.2 billion extra in by 2030. With such a huge population, the demand for safe food will be greater. Healthier, functional and personalized food will be in demand. For such huge population, we have to find how to feed them protein sources. So there will be many research going on to provide different alternative protein sources, only not from animal, but from plant as well as from insects. there is a huge growth in the middle class population. The middle class population are the one who drive your economy, who drive your market value. And they are definitely, because of all this medicine and healthier food and healthier in health infrastructure, the growth of people age 65 has increased a lot. And I'll go back to now milk. Ms. Dr. Chatranek has already discussed that how from 1950 the milk has increased. The forecast, I'll only discuss about the forecast. You can see in 2025, we will have 283.3 million liters of the milk. Now, if I go to the base route of milk production, currently India is the biggest milk producing country in the world. But if we see presently, see this is last year's report, we produced roughly 188 million metric tons, 100% production. But out of that, 54% was market surplus and 46% was local consumption. What local consumption means, the farmer producing it are only selling 54% outside and 46% is in their own consumption. So for processing industry, this much milk is available. There also, there's again two different sectors. One is unorganized sector, one is organized sector. So again, for the company like GIA, it comes to organized sector where only 45% of 54% of milk comes. There also, there's two segments, cooperative and private. So ultimately, we can see that for total milk produced, only 24% comes to your organized sector of the total milk produced. Now, if you go to the forecast, we can see that our government is planning to increase the milk availability in organized sector by increasing the installed capacities and for catering to the extra milk which will be available in the future. So this shows a tremendous growth which will come in next 5 years in the dairy industry. Now, apart from this, if we see how the product is sold in the market, 70% of the product is consumed as fluid milk and 30% as value-added product. And this 30% is a huge quantity and huge chunk of investment. And you can see that a CAGR of almost 5% is very constant to the coming 3 years for all the value-added products. So all this market trend says that India has a lot of milk and it has a lot of opportunity to improve its processing, improve its marketability, and improve its positioning in the market. So this was the introduction about market trend. Let's see what GIA does in the term of liquid processing. As you can see, the milk is produced on the farm. So GIA is there in dairy farming. We provide the dairy milking machines, milking machine parlor, even a smaller unit to a rotary parlor. When the milk comes to your processing plant, we provide complete processing unit to pasteurize, to separate cream, to homogenize, and to make different value-added products. So GIA is present throughout the milk generation until it comes to yourself in your fridge. So presence of GIA is that vast in the dairy industry. Now I have chosen a very few of the unit operation, which I thought will be very interesting for the student who is a vast demographic in this presentation. So I'll be coming to separation. Separation is basically you have to remove solids from the liquid based on density difference by application of centrifugal force. For example, in whole milk, if you feed a whole milk to separator, you can get skim milk and cream and sludge, any foreign particle that is coming with your milk. Let me show you a quick video to explain how the process works. See, till now we saw how the separator looks from inside, how the process works. This is the one of the most important process in the advancement in the separation technology. Earlier, there was solid bowl separator, which you had to clean every 4 to 5 hours because there were deposition of this sludge. So you have to remove the disc ball, you have to remove all the plate, clean it, assemble it again. So your timing of production was very limited because of this manual cleaning. Now, this is a very interesting development wherein this is the place where your solid accumulates the sludge. This is the bowl. There's water filled in these gaps here, and it has a sliding piston. After every short interval, when the sludge is connected here, this water is drained so that the bowl comes to the level of the discharge wall. And you can see then the separator will discharge the sludge. All this discharge is done periodically. Say in 1 hour or in every 20 minutes, there will be a solid collection in the solid catcher, and it will get discharged periodically every 20 minutes. Now you have seen all, this is only the pictorial representation of the clarifier. In case it was separator, you'll have a cream stream and you have a skim milk stream going out. But this is a clarifier, so it's a clarified stream that you can collect. So we got unclarified liquid coming in, solids are collected here, which is periodically discharged, and clarified liquid is collected and discharged from a different outlet. So this was the basis of separation, basic of separation. You can see here how a skimming bowl look. A skimming bowl means you will have an inlet for your whole milk. You will have these discs for bowl. This is the bowl top. This is your distributor, which will distribute your milk into these rising channels. This is the ejection port for the sludge to come out. And these are the discs stack. So let's see how it works in case of milk. You're feeding whole milk. This is the distribution channel for the whole milk. Cream being lighter goes towards the center. Skim milk being heavier comes to outlet of the bowl. Now sludge will be deposited here and periodically it will be removed. So there is one inlet from top and there is two outlet again from top. One for skim milk and one for your cream. And solid will be ejected from here as we have seen in the previous video. Now what advancement here we have done further to this self-cleaning separator. See, for every 20 minutes, if you have to remove this sludge, a part of skim milk also goes out through it. So we thought how to increase this timing, how to make it more and more wider or more and more place to catch more and more sludge and reduce the milk water quantity in it so that we increase the timing of ejection and we do not lose much of the skim milk in the process. Then Gia invented this skimming bowl with Pro Plus. You will see only extra thing here is this separation disc is mechanically enlarged. What this does is when you feed the whole milk, and when it gets separated from cream and skim milk is generated here, Now skim milk has a proper channel to go through. So this solid can get more denser. So from 20 minutes of ejection, you can go up to one ejection in 1 hour. So instead of doing, say, three ejection, you are doing only one ejection. So this is one of the advancement done by GIA to reduce your solid losses. Solid losses means your skim milk losses, your protein losses in that skim milk. Now moving ahead, we know milk is collected by from so many places, and bacteria is always an issue. Microbial quality of milk is always an issue in India. So we have modified a separator to perform as bacteria removing separator. Now you can see there is a very definitive density difference between the skim milk, cream, as well as the bacteria. So using those density difference, we can remove the bacteria from the milk, and the efficiency through which we can remove is we can remove up to 70 to 90% of total bacteria count, as well as we can remove 90 to 95% of aerobic and 98% of anaerobic bacteria. So here you can see we have got the raw milk. You got a clarified milk here. This is the zone of recollection of bacteria. We circulate it once again into the raw milk. Why this collection is being circulated? Because bacteria has a tendency to join with each other. When the bacteria cells joins and forms a clump, it has more density difference, so it can be effectively removed through the sludge discharge. So here you see there is a three-phase separation. You have a milk coming, there is a clarified milk, there is a recirculation of the bacteria laden milk, and you get your bacteria discharged through the sludge. Now this is very mandatory in all the value added products. If you talk about cheese, without bacteria removing separator, without the milk, which is a very good microbial quality milk, the cheese quality will affect drastically. So this is one of the innovation by GIA with which you can ensure that every milk which we are processing through the system has an optimum and best quality of microbiology, minimum and minimum bacteria load in the milk. Apart from using the separation technology to make it self-cleaning, to make it to clarify milk, to remove cream, to remove bacteria, a different approach has also been taken by GIA to increase the efficiency of the motor. In 1970, all the separators were produced were with gear drive. With gear drive, the efficiency which you get is only 76% because of losses in motor, clutch, and gear. In 1985, GIA introduced a belt drive system instead of the gear drive system. It effectively increased the motor efficiency to 90% complete. And then again, yet again, GIA introduced in 2009 a direct drive separator. A direct drive separator means on the motor shaft itself directly, the bowl is connected. There is no other medium in between. So this is the highest efficiency which you can get in the present market in the separator through the direct drive. Other advantages of the direct drive system is it takes much lesser space compared to belt drive or gear drive. The maintenance is very easy. So all these little things add up to the saving your processing time, saving your downtime, increasing your processing time, and in turn give you a whole system which is effective in producing the best quality of the products. Now, apart from this separation, I have touched up on homogenization, because in dairy it has its own importance. Homogenization is simply breaking a fat molecule to a smaller molecule so that it is homogeneously dispersed in the milk suspension. Now we'll basically see how what a homogenizer is made of. There is basically two parts. One is compression block and one is homogenizing valve. Compression block increases the pressure through which you will push your product to the homogenizing wall. All the homogenization is done in this wall itself. Here you can see, this is your milk with different sizes of fat globule in it. Now you increase the pressure through which you're pushing it through homogenization wall. When it reaches the wall, it creates a turbulence, it creates local cavitation, there's a high shear stress and impact speed, which result in breaking of fat molecule in a very small size. Now why? How small you have to go? You have to go so small that the size does not get any terminal speed to reach to your, when your milk is stored, it should not reach, it should not have that diameter which gives it a terminal speed which makes the cream rise, the fat globule rise in your stored milk. Basically, it should be so small that it creates a Brownian movement inside the milk and it will never, never, never separate out from it because of Brownian movement. Now this looks, this doesn't look very pictorial how you will imagine what this impact head looks like. So this is how the wall look. You can see this is the impact head. This is the standard gap making device. You will see there is two different stages. First, this impact head has a wider range and this one, it has a very small range. So all these are chosen depending on what product you are using. Homogenization is not only done in milk, done in very different food products altogether. Now, what advancement GIA has done in this homogenizing wall? Because homogenization has been done from ages. So what we have improved in it, how we have improved? GIA has introduced a nano wall concept. What nano wall concept is? The impact head design, in order to have a very homogeneous mixture with a very high efficiency, we have reduced the size from impact head and we have increased the speed so that at the same pressure, you achieve the same homogenization efficiency as you would have achieved earlier. I'll give you the clarity here. So this is the normal homogenizing wall. And this is the nano wall. You can see the gap is very small. It is reduced. Now, if you are pushing a liquid, say at 200 bar pressure here, the milk, and after that you are getting a homogenization efficiency, a creaming index of say less than 10. In case of nano wall, you can use only 180 bar and you will get the same efficiency, same creaming index of less than 10 or less than 7. So you can see a homogenizer with 250 bar pressure will have a very huge motor on it, so very high operation cost. Now same efficiency you can get with 180 bar. So your motor sizes reduces drastically. So it is one kind of saving where you are not at all playing with the quality of product. The quality of product remains the same. So this homogenizing wall, this nano wall technology is available across all the food sector, but in dairy, it is available up to the application of 250 bar and the capacity is 5,000 to 80,000 liters per hour. Now moving to another very important unit operation in any industry, is your flow component. How you transfer your product from one place to another. We all do it by using pump, flow plates and all. I'll not go in detail with any pump and any other type of wall, but I would focus majorly on a mixed proof wall. I hope you will be able to see the video. Please let me know if you are not able to see it. Here you can see this video shows how the GIA mixed proof wall looks like. I can see there is some problem in. I'll keep on pausing and explaining it. this is the standard dairy plant where you store your milk. You have n number of tanks and you have a wall battery, or you have a requirement of filling the milk in, say, two tanks, emptying the milk to MPL from another tank, transferring the milk to another MPL for another tank, or CIP of this tank. All this can be done simultaneously with the help of mixed proof wall. This is what this video will explain. Here you can see, this is the first head of the mixed proof wall and this is the second. Now you can have a different liquid flowing through the first and different liquid flowing to the second. Even if there is any leak, say here, it will always open to the environment. It will not mix with the next stream. So because of all these varieties of mixed proof wall, we can perform so many different functions simultaneously. All this is very much important when you are dealing with any industry more than which process more than 1 lakh liters of milk per day. Now moving to one of my favorite topic, that is membrane filtration. Membrane filtration has been there since ages, but its application in dairy is quite new, especially in India. Membrane filtration is basically the process of separation of solid from liquid by passing it through a selectively permeable or semi-permeable membrane. Now this separation I'll explain basically only related to dairy here, because membrane filtration has a vast application throughout any industry. But our focus will be to dairy only. Now the type of filtration, there are two type of filtration based on flow. One is dead end filtration, wherein the feed is perpendicular to your membrane. So after a certain time, the membrane gets clogged and you have to change the complete membrane and restart your filtration. Second is cross flow filtration, where the feed is parallel to your membrane. As the feed is parallel to the membrane, with the force of it, it never settles on the membrane. So you can do your filtration for a continuous period of time. So in cross flow filtration, in the tubes of the membrane, you enter the feed, you get a permeate, and whatever is left before the membrane, that is your retentive, whatever is retained, Now let's see how many kind of membrane filtration is there, how many types of membrane separation is done. So this will basically depend on how many kind of membranes we have made. So first is microfiltration. In microfiltration, the thing which will be retained will only be suspended particles. If you go to ultrafiltration, only high molecular weight particles, molecules will be retained, else any low molecular weight, salt and water will pass through that membrane. Coming to nanofiltration, only low molecular weight membrane will be retained along with high molecular whatever suspended particle is there. Only salt and water will pass through it. Now coming to reverse osmosis, only water passes through that membrane. So this is the most loose membrane and this is the most tight membrane. Reverse osmosis and microfiltration. Now coming to the microfiltration in focus, the microfiltration is a low pressure filtration where the typical pressure is only 1 to 3 bar. Now as you can see, I have divided milk. Milk has a constituent, these constituent in it: fat, protein, bacteria, lactose, salt and water. So fat definitely will be retained in your microfiltration membrane. So will be the bacteria. In protein, a whey protein can pass through it, but casein will be retained here. All lactose will pass through it, salt and water will definitely pass through the membrane. So what will be the typical application of using this microfiltration in dairy? First of all, if you want to remove fat from your solution, nothing else, so you can use this microfiltration. If you want to remove bacteria from the solution, you can use microfiltration. The typical application of microfiltration remains bacterial reduction in skim milk, extended shelf life skim milk, cold sanitation and clarification of cheese brine. This is one of the very interesting topic. As we have seen here, bacteria can be removed from the membrane filtration in microfiltration. So can yeast. In the brine solution in cheese factory, the brines are aged a lot and the same brine you keep on using. It also affects the quality of cheese. So if you have an inline microfiltration system, the cheese will always, the brine will always be clarified and your quality of cheese will not get hampered. Next is protein fractionation on skim milk. As we have seen that whey protein will pass through in microfiltration and casein will be retained. So you can fractionate your protein in skim milk. Skim milk has basically major two types of protein. One is casein and one is whey proteins. Now, if you want to use it for protein standardizations, say for example, very interesting application has come up in cheese industry. You have a cheese, say vat for 5 kL and you want to increase its yield. All you have to do is pass the milk through microfiltration, increase the casein content, standardize it to the ratio whatever it is there, 0.6, 0.7 with the fat, and from the same 5 kL of vat you will get more protein, more cheese, because you are removing the excess whey protein. You are reducing the quantity but increasing the protein content in that quantity. So this is one of the application which we have done so many times, where in a set industry, by adding only the microfiltration system, the yield has increased to 16%. Then we'll discuss further about the value added product, that is whey, in which we will see how microfiltration is used in making whey protein concentrate as well as whey protein isolate. Now moving to the next filtration, that is ultrafiltration. Ultrafiltration pressure is a bit higher than membrane filtration, ranging from 2 bar to 12 bar. In ultrafiltration, along with any fat, bacteria, all the protein will be retained. Lactose will pass through it, salt will pass through it. So now if we think about milk, we can apply it to increase the protein content in the milk. We can apply it to reduce the lactose content in the milk, because there is many, many people who are lactose intolerant. And if we talk about whey, then we can use it in way to increase the protein content in one of the stream, remove the lactose, and then dry that stream to get high protein powders. So typical application remain milk protein standardization, milk protein concentrate. If you want to make a powder which is high in protein, you reduce the lactose by passing it through ultrafiltration and increase the protein content, and you can dry it further. And you have milk protein concentrate, which is available mixed with many other ingredients in bodybuilding products, which we get these days in gyms and all. Then whey protein concentrate is another very important value-added product, which has flooded the market to all the health-conscious people. We'll discuss this in detail in my value-added section. Same lactose reduction I discussed with you. Many people are lactose intolerant. So for them, reduction of lactose in milk enables them to have dairy product. The next filtration system is nanofiltration. Here, apart from bacteria, protein, and fat, lactose can be retained. Salt will pass through it. Now, going to the further in depth of the kind of salt present in milk, you have divalent and monovalent kind of salts. So only monovalent kind of salt will pass through this, and your divalent salt cannot pass through this nanofiltration membrane, because anything greater than 100 kg will not pass through this nanofiltration. So the typical application where you can use the nanofiltration is basically in whey. In whey, if you want to reduce the ash content, you have to pass it through nanofiltration. Another typical application is chemical recovery in CIP. In the dairy CIP, caustic is used in a vast scale, and it is drained, and so many issues with doing the ETP of the chemical. And for this zero, all this, we are moving ahead to a society where we try and make a factory as less effluent, zero effluent generating factory as possible. So one of the application there is to recover the chemical which you use in the CIP and reuse it. So nanofiltration is one of the process, because as you can see, monovalent ion will pass through the stream. So you can have a clarified caustic system. Then again, for partial demineralization, we'll discuss this in value added product. Last is reverse osmosis kind of filtration. This is the tightest membrane and highest pressure membrane. Only water passes through it. So what will be the basic application? Wherever you want to remove water from a solution, you can use reverse osmosis. If you want to concentrate your milk, you can use reverse osmosis. You want to concentrate whey. If you want to recover water from a solution, you can use reverse osmosis. Typical application here again is pre-concentration. Say there is already an existing evaporation plant, but you want to increase its capacity. So you introduced a slightly concentrate feed, say from 8.5% ES to 12% ES, and you get a higher yield from the evaporation plant. Then concentration. Now we know through whole nook and corner of India, we produce so much milk, and all the milk has to be collected and transferred to the dairy facilities. And even dairy facilities are far away from each other. So one of the very cutting edge application of reverse osmosis is to concentrating the skim milk and transferring the concentrated skim milk, so that your transportation cost is cut by half. Say you have to transport a 1 lakh liter of milk per day. A dairy has to transport it to its another processing location, 1 lakh liter. For that, you need 4 25 KL tankers. If you do the reverse osmosis of the milk, your whole capacity comes down to 50 KL. And now you have to only transfer it in 2 tankers. The cost of transportation is reduced. Now, when the milk reaches the new facility, there it can be diluted with your RO water and it can be used again. So this is one of the 20th century application of this reverse osmosis. And we have provided at least 5 to 6 plants all over India where the big dairies transport the concentrate milk. And one of the major pro or advantage of using membrane filtration is all these processes are done at very low temperature, say 8 degrees Celsius. So your product are very safe. Any flavor change is not there. There is only no denaturation of protein. There is no problem with flat fat molecules. So this process helps the big dairies to transfer the milk in very effective way, very cost effective way, and retain the quality of milk. Because if you transport a evaporator condensate milk, once you do the evaporation of the milk, it loses its flavor. It has a cooking taste to it, which is not there in the reverse osmosis. Now, another application, one of the interesting application is in any of the drying plant, in evaporation plant, there's a lot of condensate generated every hour. And those are a very murky condensate. A bit of solid is there, so you cannot use it as it is in your cleaning or anything. So if you do the reverse osmosis of those condensate, you get a RO water, which otherwise was going directly to your effluent treatment plant. Now you can use that water to the CIP of any other equipment you like. So this is also, you are reducing the generation of any effluent in your plant by using such technology, by such innovative applications of membrane filtration. Now this was my unit operation which wanted to touch up on the innovation part. I have also a small presentation for value added product. In value added product, we have so many products to choose from, but I have focused on the one which the present youth is very favorable to, that is any kind of strained yogurt. So Greek style yogurt has come into market in a very big way. Earlier, it was majorly focused in USA and Middle Europe, but now it has made its way to India also. Because of all this health consciousness, what this Greek yogurt means is you make a yogurt, a simple curd, you remove the whey from it. The minute you remove the whey from it, you are concentrating the protein. You concentrate the protein, you make it a very high protein and high quality product in the market, which is much, much better than your normal curd. It has a great texture, it has a high dry content in dry matter in it, and it just works with the younger youth. But Greek yogurt production has been a manual production where you make the curd and you hang them in these muslin clothes to drain the whey. Now, to make anything go on a larger scale, you cannot have a manual intervention like this, where hygiene will be an issue, where production time will be an issue, where even the drainage from this bag to this bag, the quality will be an issue. So here comes Gia, how to do this in a continuous way. So again, we have used our separator, centrifugation technology, to make a Greek style yogurt or strained yogurt. So this is your tank where you heat them, you store the heated milk, you add the culture, your curd is set. You strain it and pass it through a nozzle separator. I'll show you ahead what a nozzle separator is. What it does basically is you feed your curd, it removes the whey from it, and you get a solid mass, which you cool, you store, you can add n number of fruits in it, flavors in it, you can sell it, pack it as it is. So we have seen in the market, there are so many different varieties of yogurt present. So this is the simplest way of making Greek style yogurt. Now, what is the benefit of using a separator here is your product is standardized. You will get the same quality of product every time you are processing it. So I have a very quick video explaining all those things which I just said in a nutshell.
How to make strained yogurt? A product like Greek style, Lebanon, Skia. Start with milk, heat to fermentation temperature, add yogurt culture to it, Let it rest until acidified. Strain the whey and you're done. You can add fruit or flavor to your liking. So rather easy, no? To strain your yogurt on an industrial scale can easily be done with a Ghia separator. Why using a Ghia separator? It allows you to process larger volumes, retaining a perfect mouthfeel and structure in a hygienic and controlled way. On top of it, you increase the yield of your production by standardizing the yogurt concentration, and you produce a constant high-quality product your customers are looking for.
So we have seen how a yogurt, a Greek-style yogurt, is produced. By using this nozzle separator, this is how the schematic it looks like. It has one entry for your curd. Your whey will be collected near the center of it. You will get your strained curd out through these nozzles. This is quite different from a normal separator, a centrifuge, a milk separator. It's quite different from it. This is how it works. This is your curd coming in. You remove the whey. Whey is collected separately. This is your fresh strained yogurt or curd out from the nozzle. Now, this application cannot only make Greek style yogurt, but there is a number of products present in market with the name of fresh cheese. You must have seen in the market these Amul cream cheese. Those are made with such kind of separator. Thermoquark can be an example for Srikhand. There is double cream cheese, there is strained yogurt, different kind, and Greek yogurt, of course. So this is all the variety of yogurt which can be prepared by just a new technology of separation. And it is very interesting value-added product in the market, and which is picking up quite fast. Now, next product, value-added product, which I have focused on is whey. Whey, a decade ago, was a havoc for dairy industry, how to handle the whey. And since the whey powder, the whey protein, we knew how to utilize it, it became a second source of income for the dairy. And we have seen there are basically three different kinds of whey powder. First is generally whatever whey you create out of cheese plant, you can demineralize it and evaporate it, crystallize it and spray dry it. That is a normal whey powder, which is not very high in protein. But next point is you concentrate the protein in the whey and you get different grades of say 30 whey, WPC 35 means 35% protein in that powder. 80 means 80% protein. And the last is minimum 90% protein, which is called whey protein isolate. So all products flooding in the market for all those gym enthusiasts is nothing but this whey concentrate and a mixture of milk protein concentrate and all these protein together. The photo which here is avatar, the pic which you can see here. This is coming out of Ghia plant only. So let's see what the process of whey powder is. As I said, the first is demineralized whey powder. There's a different grades of demineralized whey powder. Demin 40 means you have to remove 40% of ash present in the whey generated after cheese. So the first process is you collect the raw whey, you pasteurize it, you clarify and separate the cream out of it. You store the whey in a pasteurized silo. Now you pass it through nanofiltration. What will happen when you pass it through nanofiltration is the monovalent salt will pass through it in the permeate. So the retentive, the concentrate which you are getting has less minerals in it than it was in feed. Now the concentrate of the NF, depending on what grade of demineralization you want to do, either you can do electrodialysis, you can do ion exchange, or simply if you want to do it for 30% demineralization, you can directly feed it to evaporator. You concentrate it further, then you crystallize it. It has a huge quantity of lactose in it. So this needs to be crystallized before you feed it to the spray dryer. So this is a typical process of making whey powder. The next kind of whey powder is whey protein concentrate. Now the pre-treatment remains same. You pasteurize the whey, clarify, separate the cream out of it. First step, you concentrate it in nanofiltration. You remove a part of ash from it, a part of water from it. That water can be recovered from RO polisher and can be used back for CIP. Now the concentrate which you got, NF concentrate, which has protein and less mineral in it, you pass it through ultrafiltration. What ultrafiltration will do, as we have seen earlier, it will remove the lactose from it. Now depending on what amount of protein you want in the product, that much amount of lactose has to be reduced. So say for WPC-35, you reduce a certain amount of lactose. If you want to make WPC-80, you have to remove all of a maximum amount of lactose through it. So depending on the grade of fruit powder you want, the ultrafiltration will change. For the maximum, say 80 or 70% and above, we have to add a diafiltration system into it to wash out the protein as much as possible. So whatever you get from the ultrafiltration, the concentrate part of it, the TVR evaporator is optional here because the TS here is generally to 25 to 27%. We can directly feed it to spray dryer and you get your whey protein concentrate. Now the permeate, which is high in lactose, you can dry it again in a different dryer and you can get a whey permeate powder, which is in high demand in any bakery industry. Now, apart from whey protein concentrate, there is a market of even higher protein content powder, that is minimum 90% protein. So that is whey protein isolate. In this case, as we know, in the whey, in the feed whey, the protein normally is 0.5 to 0.7% only. The TS of the feed whey for the pasteurized whey is roughly, say for cheddar or mozzarella, is only 5.5%. In that 5.5%, 0.5 to 0.7% is your protein, whey protein. And roughly 4 to 4.2% or 4.5% is the lactose. So now, if you want to make a whey protein isolate wherein 90% of the powder is protein, so you have to remove as much as possible of all the other content into it. So first step, we take the pasteurized whey, we remove the cream from the whey, we take a pasteurized whey, we transfer it to ultrafiltration. In first step, we remove the lactose as much as possible so that your protein content is 50% in the stream. Now you take this retentate and it has to pass through microfiltration. Why microfiltration? Because the fat content, even if it is 0.06% in case of your feed whey, it will improve so many fold that you cannot get a final 90% protein. So you have to defat this whey by passing it through microfiltration, because we have learned that microfiltration can defat your milk or your whey. So here we are using microfiltration for defattening. Once we did the defattening of this WPC-50, means 50% protein, we again pass it through ultrafiltration, a different skid, to again further increase the protein and remove the further lactose, remove all other ingredients from it. So, and now you get a WPC-90. That liquid you can pass through spray dryer and you will get a whey protein isolate. Now, as we have two ultrafiltration system, you have two permeate coming out of it. Those are, both of them are high lactose stream. This lactose can pass through nanofiltration. It is also an optional to recover, to concentrate the lactose, and further different lactose derivative can be made out of it, depending on what quality of lactose you want to produce. So for value added product, my major focus was only on this Greek style yogurt and this way. So we have done through with our presentation. I hope if anyone have any questions, you can mention. And thank you. Thank you, Dr. Kale.
Thank you, ma'am. Now, I must mention our deep sense of appreciation for Ms. Swati Singh, ma'am, for giving an excellent coverage about advanced technology solutions for liquid milk processing and value-added products. At the end, I again thank you, ma'am, for being with us on the occasion of Dairy Engineers Day. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
As we are moving forward in the session, I would like to introduce our next speaker, Engineer Santosh Chopra sir. From the last 8 years, he is engaged in teaching, research and extension activities in the dairy area. He has published more than 20 national and international research papers, one book and 8 book chapters. Currently, in the capacity of the principal investigator, he is undertaking extramural research projects funded by the Rajiv Gandhi Science and Technology Commission, Government of Maharashtra. Now, I would like to request Engineer Santosh Chopra sir to share his knowledge with us. Over to Santosh sir.
Thank you, moderator sir. Please confirm me when my PPT is visible.
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay, thank you. So, at the outset, I would like to thank Parul University Administration and GIA Processing Engineering Private Limited India for giving me this opportunity to talk as a resource person here at this extraordinary platform. So friends, before I begin, I would like to offer my humble tribute to India's foremost engineer, Bharat Ratna, and the greatest, one of the greatest nation builder of the last century, Sir M. Viswasaraiah ji. And I wish all engineers who are attending this webinar, very happy Engineers Day. Friends, as you all know, engineering has got various streams, and being related to or engaged in food engineering, we have a liability to ensure food security for the nation. Apart from this, we have also got the responsibility to ensure that on continuous basis, research will go and our consumers, our citizens will get novel foods which will promote health and well-being. And linked to this, I will be presenting a technology, spray drying encapsulation technology, through which or it has proven as a tool for developing functional food products. Okay, so today I will be talking on advances in spray drying encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients. So the content of my presentation is here. In the introduction, I will be talking on encapsulation technology, its various types of encapsulation. In the next few slides, I will be talking on the applications of encapsulation in food industry and what different methods are available for encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients. And in the end, I will shift on what advances has occurred in the spray drying encapsulation technology. So friends, in introduction, this is the basic definition of encapsulation, that it is a process to entrap one substance that is the active agent within another substance known as a wall material. Friends, when it comes to food application, this definition can be modified as a process to entrap bioactive molecules in coating material so as to improve their delivery at target site under controlled rate. Friends, you all know bioactive agents are highly unstable to environment conditions, like when they are exposed to oxygen, when they are exposed to higher temperature, degradation occurs, and that decreases its bioavailability. So first product containing microencapsulated material, it came in 1954, and it was related to pharmaceutical industry. As such, in 1960, first study on microencapsulation of microencapsulation in food technology was conducted, and the encapsulated substances, they are called as an active agent, and the core, the fill, they are also known as the internal or payload phase, and the one which act as a wall material or encapsulating agent, they are called as a coating, membrane, shell, capsule, or carrier material or matrix. Here, the pink sphere represents the core material, and the yellow coating, this separates the core material, which is the active material, from the environment, thereby protecting it against degradation or adverse conditions in the environment. So this in this slide, I will be talking about the food encapsulation market. So friends, as you can see, in 2019, $34 billion, American billion dollar, this is the market of food encapsulation, and the compounded average growth rate is 7.6 for the year 2020 to 2026. So with this growth, the market in 2026 will be $55 billion. And now if we talk about the what different processes which are used for microencapsulation, the encapsulation, the microencapsulation has got highest market. It covers $12 billion revenue share in the encapsulation market. The third chart, it shows the what different bioactive molecules are encapsulated today, or which are available in the market. So as you can see, vitamins, especially the fat soluble vitamins A, D, E, K, they have covered almost $5 billion revenue share and encapsulation market. And the other which are of importance are minerals, enzymes, probiotics, and sweeteners. So if you see, this market is continuously growing, and the driving forces behind this are encapsulation technology leads to improved shelf life product. There is a reduced nutrient losses, okay, as the coating material prevents degradation, and there is a controlled release of ingredient at active site. Okay, so these are the three factors which has taken this encapsulation market. Now this is the pictorial representation of encapsulation process. So here bioactive molecules, they includes chemical and biological properties, and stability is the problem. So they have been we can use generally recognized as safe material to cover to encapsulate them. So this shell materials, they have to be preferably water soluble, and then you can use different encapsulation technologies, and you can form coating material, coating or shell or food matrix using encapsulation technologies, and then that functional food you can ingest or in the host, and you will get the therapeutic benefit. So why, what is the necessity or purpose of encapsulation? First, it increases the bioavailability and solubility of core compounds. Friends, let's take example of curcumin here. Curcumin, as you all know, it's a anti-inflammatory substance. It has got antioxidant properties. It has many therapeutic benefits in the host. It produces many therapeutic effects in the host. So, but the major disadvantage about the curcumin is that when you take it as such, bioavailability is very less. Okay, so and in encapsulated form, the bioavailability is very high. It is released at targeted size, means in the intestine. So that's a first advantage of encapsulation technology. Second advantage is that you can it facilitates the packaging, transportation, commercialization of the products. Then third advantage or purpose behind encapsulation is to mask the unwanted properties such as unpleasant smell or flavors. Hence, acceptance of food primarily decided by the sensorial properties of food products. If you are adding bioactive molecules which affects the sensorial properties of food, it will not be accepted by the consumers. So you have to use encapsulation technology to mask this unpleasant smells or flavors. Then the fourth advantage is that it produces a shelf stable products. Okay, this we have discussed in the previous slides. Next is the possibility of applying different innovative, fast and scalable techniques. Yes, if the bioactive molecule is encapsulated, you can use different techniques as it is more stable. You can scale the processing techniques also, because the product has got more stability. It could resist the harsh conditions during the food processing and storage. Then it prevents degradation of food ingredients during both processing conditions and storage. Then it improves the microbiological stability and food preservation. So this is specifically applied to probiotic food. There, the viability of probiotic microbes is very important. It has to be 10 to the power 7 CFU per gram. If it has to produce some therapeutic benefits in the host. So that can be ensured with this encapsulation technology. And this technology is very widely explored for its use in probiotic encapsulation. Now the types of encapsulation. See here, the industries are primarily working on this micro encapsulation and nano encapsulation. Other technologies are there, hybrid technology and other, but these two have covered a majority of the market. So first, micro encapsulation, they are based on the encapsulated particle size. They have been classified as a micro encapsulation and nano encapsulation. So micro encapsulation will have the final product particle size will be in the range of micrometer. And here in nano encapsulation, the bioactive molecules of nanometer size will be encapsulated, and then they will be put in the food matrix. So the functionality of microencapsulation is protection of bioactive compound. It leads to the control release profile. It marks the undesirable flavors. It improves the flow properties. It increases the shelf life of the product. And then the product enrichment with the specific nutrient. Yes, this one is there. Then the functionality of nano encapsulation. See, as we go to the nanometer scale, what happens? The surface area of the total surface area available gets increased, and the bioactive molecules are very well absorbed in the target sites, and that's why it increases the bioavailability. It also leads to better release rate of the bioactive molecules. So these are the some of the functionality of nano encapsulations. It reduces the particle size, creating narrow particle distribution. It leads to a formation of higher surface area. It enhances the delivery of bioactive protections. It improves the bioavailability. It enhances the physical stability and produces long shelf life products. There is a better precision targeting and passing through the minute body fenestration. There is an enhancement of reactivity barrier between the bioactive and other compounds or ingested mediums, and there is improved intracellular uptake. Now this slide shows the application of encapsulation in food industry. Friends, here if you directly add bioactive molecules like polyunsaturated fatty acids, vitamins, bioactive polysaccharides, minerals, polyphenols, bioactive peptides into food product, what is going to happen? They will change the sensorial properties of food products. And as you know, they are unstable. So if you add 1 gram of, say, 1 gram of bioactive compound, bioactive molecule, and if it has to produce some bioavailability of 2, then while processing, there will be some degradation. The bioavailability value will come down. During when host consumes it orally, it has to pass through its GIT. So there, because of adverse condition, degradation will take place. So it will not be the therapeutic advantage will not be fully utilized. Okay. So for that, encapsulation is very necessary. So if you add directly, there will be less shelf life, there will be less bioavailability, less concentration of bioactive molecules. It will lead to different sensorial properties and uncontrolled release of compounds. So these are the technological challenges with the bioactive compounds. They are sensitive to oxygen, light, heat, water, food processing, handling, storage, and physiological digestion environments. Okay. Then what different methods are available for encapsulation? Co-acervation, co-crystallization, molecular inclusion, spray drying, spray cooling, spray chilling, extrusion, fluidized bed, melt injection, and liposome. These are the very commonly used encapsulation methods. Out of this, spray drying is very commonly used method. As you can see in the pie chart, around 78% of encapsulated products are prepared by using spray drying method. Why? Because it's an economical method, and it allows you to produce or carry out your production at commercial level. This is very important. When any industry plans for encapsulated to launch encapsulated product in the market, commercial level is very important. So this can be possible only with spray drying. Okay. Then other technologies are there: extrusion, emulsification, fluidized, plating, co-acervation. Now, what are the benefits of What are the benefits? We'll move to this slide first. What is encapsulation process by spray drying? What are the stages or procedure of encapsulation by spray drying? Okay, so first you have to prepare emulsion. So emulsion preparation involves soaking of wall materials. coating materials, shell materials in distilled water under magnetic condition. This you have to do before one day of preparation of subjecting your product to spray drying. So soaking of all materials before 24 hours, and initially you have to put your wall materials in distilled water. You have to stir it with the magnetic stirrer, and then the emulsion is prepared by blending the core material and wall material using high shear mixer. You can also use homogenizer or ultrasonic probes, which are available in the market. But here, for the laboratory purpose, I'm using 15,500 RPM for 5 minutes. Then atomization. This is the next stage. You have to spray the emulsion, prepared emulsion, into the drying chamber. Then spray drying. As you all know, it's composed of three steps. Atomization, then the drying gas will come in contact with the atomized feed particles, and the last stage is collection of dried particles. Okay, so here preparation of emulsion, atomization, and spray drying. These are the three stages which are involved in encapsulation process by spray drying. So what are the benefits of spray drying process for micro encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients? How it is different from the other techniques? So here it controls particle size, shape, and morphology. Yes, with the help of atomizers. See, different types of atomizers are available in spray drying: a rotary atomizer, centrifugal atomizer, again pressure atomizer. So by using the one which suits your application, you can control the particle size, shape, and morphology. Similarly, it's a one-step semi-continuous process. Okay. Third advantage is that it's process simplicity, ease of operation, and scale capability. Fourth benefit is that it is possible to encapsulate highly viscous sticky feeds. So with the use of high pressure pumps, you can feed a very sticky feeds to the spray dryers. Then low operating cost, energy efficient technology, and fast process. Processing of heat sensitive substances is also possible. Because see, in spray drying, drying takes place at wet bulb temperature of air. The product particles will never exceed the temperature of wet bulb temperature of drying gas. So its temperature remains in the range of 65 to 70 degrees Celsius. So you can dry heat sensitive substances also. Then you can work with the highly viscous feeds through preheating. Yes, preheating is one option that you can utilize for drying. When you are dealing with highly viscous feeds, you can preheat it to lower down its viscosity. Then design of particles with controlled release properties. Next benefit with the spray drying is that you can it can be applicable to both hydrophilic and hydrophobic food ingredients. It has got high encapsulation efficiency and extended shelf life for the obtained powders. Then you can use various design of experiment techniques for optimizing the process. Yes, this is very, very important. You can use design of experiments based on input parameter and output parameter. You can carry out your experiment to optimum conditions so that best value product can be produced. Okay, so in the coming slides we will talk about the input and output parameters. So these are the parameters of the spray drying processes. So here, inlet and outlet temperature of the drying gas is very important, because this decides at what temperature your product is going to dry. Okay, if you use higher outlet temperature, your product, in case you are dealing with heat sensitive products, your product will get degraded. You will not get the expected quality. Okay. Then drying gas type, flow rate, humidity, and pressure. These are again very important. Drying gas type, yes. If generally HEPA filtered air is used for heated, and dehumidified air is used for drying. But if you are dealing with fatty products, in that case you can use inert gas for drying. Then humidity is very important. If you use highly humid air to dry, then you will have to increase the flow rate of a drying gas. Otherwise, wet product having higher moisture content will be produced. Then atomizer type, nozzle diameter, pressure, and wheel speed. This is related to atomization. Then pore to wall ratio in the feed. This is very important. Your emulsion should have enough or sufficient wall material so that it will cover the core. It will put coating over the core material or active material. So that you have to ensure. Generally, it's in the ratio of 4:1 to 5:1. Then feed flow rate, viscosity, temperature, and total size. These are the some factors. Now optimization. I could see some here on this platform. I could see some PG students are also there. So for them, if you are planning to work on encapsulation of bioactive molecules using spray drying technology, you can try this input parameters. You can study effects of these parameters on output parameters like encapsulation efficiency, core material loading rate, surface core content, powder yield, particle size of the final product, thermal properties. Thermal properties are not studied by many scientists, or this is in the bio, you can say this is in the initial stages. So there is a vast opportunity for the researcher to conduct work in this arena. Moisture content, density, porosity, solubility, color. You can study the release profile, how a bioactive molecule will release at targeted size using in vitro systems. You can also study the stability against processing and environmental parameters. You can optimize the input parameter based on the organoleptic and qualitative properties within the food formulation. Next these are some applications where spray drying encapsulation technologies have been widely used. So first is spray drying encapsulation of omega-3 fatty acids. So you all know EPA, DHA, ALA are essential fatty acids. Human body cannot synthesize it, so it has to be taken externally through the foods, and these are present in good amount in the fish, flaxseed, walnut. If they are not taken on daily basis, what has to be done? You can fortify your daily food items with this bioactive molecules. Okay, and through fortification, it can be a part of your daily diet. Then spray drying encapsulation of probiotics. Here, many probiotic microbes have been encapsulated. Some species are Lactobacillus plantarum, Saccharomyces cerevisiae, Lactobacillus casei, and many more. The third application is spray drying encapsulation of phenolic compounds and natural colorants. So among natural colorants, anthocyanins, carotenoids like beta carotene, lycopene, lutein, vaccin, norvaccin. These compounds are encapsulated using spray drying technologies. Similarly, under phenolic compounds, phenolic acids, flavonoids, curcumin, catechins, resveratrol. These compounds have been encapsulated. Now I'm moving to nano spray drying as an emerging process for nano encapsulation of bioactive compounds. Up till now, I was talking about spray drying technology for micro encapsulation. Now I'm moving to some advances in spray drying technology. So nano encapsulation is a potential alternative in protection and preservation of the bioactive compounds and increases their bioavailability, stability, and targeted release. Most recent trend in encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients. Its final particle will have a size in the range of 100 to 1000 nanometer. And this is the number of research paper published from 2010 up to September 2020. Okay. So from this increasing graph, you can predict that number of researchers going on application of nanospray drying in encapsulation of bioactive ingredient is continuously increasing, and in the coming year you could see a nano encapsulated, you could see many products in nano encapsulated forms. Can we use conventional spray dryer for nano spray drying? The answer is no. Why? Because this has got these major constraints. First constraint is that you cannot produce nano size droplets for conversion into nanoparticles. This is the first constraint with the conventional spray dryer. Second major constraint with the conventional spray dryer is that the nanoparticles which are produced, if you use an atomizer in the latest technologies for production of nanoparticles, still you cannot be able to collect that produced nanoparticle using cyclone systems. See, in conventional spray dryer, cyclone battery of cyclone or back filters are used to collect the nanoparticles. Same system you cannot use for collection of nanoparticles. It fails to collect that. Then third major constraint is that gas flow within the drying chamber. In conventional spray dryer, very turbulent type of flow is there for drying gas. If you apply the same with the nanoparticles, what is going to happen? Nanoparticles will stick to the walls of the drying chamber and they will get deposited there before drying, and it will be very hard to recover them. Now these are the novel technologies which have been added in the nano spray dryer. This nano spray dryer it came in the recent past. It has been developed by Bucci Technologies. Here you can extend spray drying to submicron scale, and the technology's novelty which allows you to do so are: first one is vibrating mesh spray technology. Second is the gentle laminar drying gas flow technology. Third is the highly efficient electrostatic particle collector. This is the image of nano spray dryer, and in the next slide we will talk about the technological novelties. First is vibrating mesh technology. So friends, you all must have heard piezoelectric actuator word. So these three technologies are not newly invented. They were there in the past. They have been applied. They have been utilized for production of submicron particles. So piezoelectric actuators, these are nothing but the transducers which converts electrical energy into mechanical displacement. So this technology, this actuators are used in vibrating mesh technologies. Here, piezoelectric actuators, they are driven by an electronic circuit, a small exchangeable, a small exchangeable cap, it is spray cap. Here it is shown here. You can remove it. It is placed onto the spray head. So this one is a peristaltic pump which pumps the fluid from your reservoir, feed reservoir to the atomizer. So here spray head, spray caps are fitted. And from here, electricity will drive the piezoelectric actuator at an ultrasonic frequency of 60 kilohertz, which is close to resonance frequency of the spray cap. So 60 kilohertz is very high frequency. It will displace, it will expand and contract at a frequency of 60 kilohertz. The piezoelectric crystal contracts and expands, resulting in upward and downward oscillation of the spray mesh. The rapid vibration causes each volt to act as a micro pump that draws the liquid through the holes to form identical size droplets. So here, as you can see, these holes act as a micro pumps from where aerosolized feed particles will be produced by the vibrating mesh technology. Now we will move to gentle laminar drying condition. So here, for producing gentle laminar drying condition, the unit has got a heating system consisting of a porous metal foam. Here, as you can see in the picture, this is a porous metal disc, and these are the porous metal foams. And in between them, a heating coil is embedded, and a porous metal surface generates a laminarization of the gas flow for gentle drying of spray droplets. So the drying gas flow rate can be adjusted within the range of 80 to 160 liter per minute, which is equivalent to gas velocities of 0.05 to 0.1 meter per second in the drying chamber. So it will generally produce Reynolds number in the range of 300 to 600, which will creep the drying gas flow in laminar fashion. Okay, so here this is fitted in the top of the drying chamber unit. We will move to the last novel technology, which is utilized in nanospray dryer, electrostatic particle collection. So here, electrostatic particle collectors are used because cyclones, they can separate only 2 micron size of powder particles. So they fail to separate particles from the exhaust air stream. So for this, it consists of a electrostatic particle collector. It consists of a stainless steel cylinder. Here it is shown. It consists of a stainless steel cylinder which acts as a anode, and it is also known as a particle collection electrode, and a star-shaped counter electrode, which acts as a cathode inside the. It is placed inside that cylinder. So from here, when this charged powder particle, which carries a negative charge, when it comes in the electrostatic particle collection chamber, what happens? It will be subject to high voltage of 50 kilowatt, and then because of as they carry negatively charged, they will be attracted towards positively charged and separation will take place. So a special feature of electrostatic particle collector is that it produces segregation effect over the length of cylinder. That means the large size nanoparticles will be collected in the top portion of cylinder, and the smaller size particles will be collected in the bottom portion. Now, optimizing the nanospray drying process parameters. So here, again, for those who wants to do the research in nano encapsulation of bioactive molecules, you can use this dark, black dark parameters as a input parameters, and gray parameters as a output parameters. You can vary the drying gas flow rate, aspirator speed, inlet temperature, vibrating frequencies of the spray cap, spray intensity. You can vary. You can vary the spray mesh size. It is available in three sizes: 4 micron, 5 micron, and 6 micron. You can change the chamber length. You can change the circulation pump rate. You can also change the feed related parameters like so emulsion, suspension. Hello. Then this is the main nanospray drying process parameters. So here, as you can see, with these are the input parameters, which changes this output parameters. So with a slight increase in the drying gas flow rate, there will be significant effect on the outlet temperature and moisture content of the product. Similarly, if you increase the drying gas humidity slightly, there will be significant increase in the moisture content of the product. When you increase the inlet temperature of drying gas slightly, there will be a significant increase in the outlet temperature, and significant decrease will be observed in the stability of the product. And there will be slight increase in the particle size and yield. So again, if you increase the spray mesh size slightly, there will be increase in the droplet size, particle size, and feed rate. If you increase the spray rate intensity, you can observe outlet temperature drop in outlet, significant drop in outlet temperature, feed rate will be increased significantly. Your particle size and droplet size will get increased slightly. Similarly, if you increase circulation pump rate, there will be slight increase in the droplet size, particle size, feed rate, and the stability of product will be improved slightly. In the same fashion, if solid concentration is increased, you can observe a slight increase in the outlet temperature. There will be a slight decrease in the moisture content of product. If you increase the surfactant or stabilizer in the feed slightly, there will be slight decrease in the particle size and droplet size, and you could get increase in feed rate, yield of the product, and stability. Similarly, if you increase the solvent instead of water, you will get significant increase in the outlet temperature. There will be increase in the feed rate and yield. Now, these are the input parameters and output parameters on what basis you can optimize the nanospray drying. Now, here I have listed some studies on nano encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients. So here, as you can see, researchers have tried to encapsulate eugenol oil, peppermint, leucine, beta galactosidase, BSA, curcumin, resveratrol, curcumin, eugenol, and they have used different inlet temperatures, 100, 175. Some of them have used 55 as it is a heat sensitive product. They have got readily dispersible product. Some other compounds are saffron extract, roasted coffee bean oil, propolis extract. Okay, now I will move to the conclusion of this in my presentation. So the nanospray drying technology could be effectively used for production of nanoparticle size. Then final quality of the product can be optimized by process parameters and product formulation. It has the ability to handle the food bioactive ingredients, which makes it an important tool for novel developments in the food industry. Future studies are still required to meet the commercial demands for their industrial scale production. The use of nanospray drying in fabrication of nanoparticles of biological active compounds, coating of flavors and other volatile substances in the foods needs to be studied. With this, I thank audience and the organizer of this webinar for allowing me to present over here. Thank you Kelly sir.
Thank you sir. Here I am.
Thank you moderator sir.
Here I am Dhruv Patel from the technology department. I would wish to express my gratitude to engineer Santosh Chopra sir for sharing excellent information regarding advances in spray drying encapsulation of food bioactive ingredients. Again, thank you, sir, for being with us on a special occasion of Engineers Day. So now, at the end, I hand over the session to Dr. Vijay Kelly, sir.
Hello. Sir. Hello. So thank you very much, Ms. Swati Singh, madam, and Engineer Santosh Chopra sir. Thank you very much. And lastly, a thanks to all experts and all participants for the such a big event. So we have planned this event in very short duration. So I specially thanks to the team of the GI Engineering and team of the Department of Dairy Technology, Parul University, and specially thanks to the experts, Mr. Rajesh Galani, Dr. Chitra Naik sir, Ms. Swati Singh, and Engineer Santosh Chopra sir. Now I hand over the session for the vote of thanks to Professor Parth Hirpal. Hello. At the end, we would like to thank all the speakers of today's session, Mr. Rajesh Galani sir, Dr. Chitra Naik sir, Ms. Swati Singh, Engineer Santosh Chopra. All the speakers had presented very wonderfully. We are very much pleased to hear from such a wonderful, knowledgeable people. A special thanks to Engineer Rajesh Shivsagar from GI Engineering. Without his kind support and help, we would not be able to plan this wonderful workshop. We also express our heartiest thanks and appreciation to all the attendees of this workshop from across the India as well as from outside the country. Last but not the least, our special thanks to Dr. Devanshu Patel sir,
President, Parul University, Dr. M.N. Patel, sir, Provost, sir, Parul University, Dr. H.S. Vijay Kumar, sir, Registrar, Parul University, Dr. Unnati Joshi, ma'am, Dean, Faculty of Engineering and Technology, Parul University, Dr. Bhavesh Mewada, sir, Principal, Parul University of Technology, and Mr. Brijesh Acharya, OSD, Parul University, for providing us their full support, guidance, and all the necessary resources for conduction of this virtual workshop. So thank you very much to all again. I'd like to request all the panelist members to leave the session. A message to the attendees, please submit the feedback form before 9 to 11 a.m.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We will mail you the certificate.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. All the attendees, after submission of your feedback form, we'll mail you the certificate personally.